everyone, welcome to Movement and Me, an initiative that is designed for budding artists across the world who wish to pursue their career in art. I'm your host Diharika, and on this show you will hear artists talk about their lives and the choices they had to make in pursuit of arts. We will also get to use some tips and key learnings from the lives of these artists along with a detailed discussion on their areas of interest. So quickly hop on to a journey into the world of arts along with us. Today's guest is Miss Radhika Kathal. She has been a dancer and a singer for more than 15 years. She has been trained under her guru, Srimati Geeta Chandran for Bharatanatyam and Dr. Soma Singh for vocals. With her passion for dance and her musical expertise, Radhika has performed pieces such as Seasons, a Bharatanatyam piece performed on Western classical music by Tchaikovsky, choreographed pieces on topics such as female feticide, and for stories such as Caligula and What the Lakya. She's also been actively engaged in creating dance curriculum and teacher training modules for various institutions and is also the primary arts anchor at Shivnatha School, Noida. She recently founded Kaladhwani, which is aimed at promoting classical dance and music by making it accessible to all. Hello, Radhika. Welcome to the podcast. And thank you so much for agreeing to doing this with us.
Hi, Niharika. Thank you for having me on the podcast. I'm really looking forward to this conversation with you.
Well, so am I. It's so exciting to finally have you on board here and the fact that we are finally able to do this. So I'm going to quickly get started with our set of questions because I'm sure the audience members are equally eager. Tell us a little bit about your journey. Where did you get started with dance? How did you get started with dance? And who was your first inspiration behind all of this?
So I belong to a non-arts family. My dad is from, he belongs to the northern part of India, and my mom belongs to the southern part of India. So I'm sort of a mixed breed there. And so there was no one in my family per se who, you know, pursued a career or even like followed dance and music. So as a child, and I'm born and brought up in Delhi. So as a child, I grew up listening to different genres of music. So from my maternal side, I used to listen to M.S. Subbalakshmi, amazing violinists and percussionists. Whereas in my paternal side, I used to listen to Geeta Dutt, Shamshad Begum, and Talat Mehmood, Hemant Kumar, Muhammad Rafi, Kishore Kumar. So, I sort of grew up listening to both the sides of the genres of the music. And it so happened that while I was singing and, in earlier days, also now, I think, but I remember that as a child, I went to a wedding. And, in those weddings, when you're dancing with the family, one of my relatives just pointed out that, oh, she dances very nice. Why don't you enroll her into a dancing school? And so that's what my mom thought. Okay, maybe that can be a beginning. And I was a little chubby kid, so my mom thought that dancing will help me lose the weight as well. So she found an institute which was near my place, which is called Jayajayavanti, and I enrolled myself there. My mom enrolled me, and I used to learn Bharatanatyam there under Dr. Sneha Chakradhar. So that's where I initiated into learning Bharatanatyam. Obviously, before that, I used to watch on TV and just like copy whatever the dance forms are doing so that's how I stepped into the world of Bharatanatyam. And at such a young age, I really did not know who should I follow as an idol, who is my inspiration. I just followed what my teacher told me to do. So I can't even say when it turned into something which I really want to pursue, because as a child, the only aim was to go to dance class, do nice dancing, get appreciation, come back, have good food and sleep, and then prepare for next class. So that was the back and forth timetable. And so that's how I started learning Bharatanatyam. And then eventually, obviously, I'm now a disciple of Padmashri Guru Geeta Chandran, and where I learned finer nuances of Bharatanatyam. So apart from adavus, how do we work in group choreographies? How do we choose a music for dance? How do we design our dance? Even speaking about your pieces. So that all these it seems very nitty-gritty things, but all these things are really important when it comes to being a dancer. And all these little things I started learning there at the institute, which my guru's institute, which is Natyaviksha. And so I really don't feel that there are I only follow this person and this is my inspiration and everything. I really admire both my gurus, Dr. Shoma Singh for music and also Geeta Akka for dance. And I really look up to them, both of them, because of their sheer simplicity of teaching these styles. And it's been 25 years that I've been dancing, and I started learning at the age of 5. And all these years I have met people who have inspired me, right? So I cannot like pinpoint one person per se that, okay, this is my idol, I want to become like this. I really want to create my own identity by learning from the experiences which I have had over these 25 years. So so that's been a glimpse of the journey in dance.
Quite an actually interesting one. What actually intrigues me in the introduction as well is the part about you following both dance and music. I mean, how did you reach to a point where you figured out that, music is also something that I have an inclination for, and that it's something that I want to continue pursuing? Because while as a dancer, you have to learn music, you don't necessarily turn into like a professional musician per se. You learn it because you are dancing, but you don't turn into a professional musician. So tell us a little bit about that.
Absolutely. Yeah. So what happened was that, I personally believe that for a dancer, it's very important to be adept in music as well. And when I say that the dancer should do music, I really don't say that he or she needs to be a very good Carnatic singer or a Hindustani classical singer. But just identifying the music and emotions behind that music and then sort of helping that in dance is actually what I mean. So, in my early years, told you that I grew up listening to a lot of music in my house, and I used to sing along with the Geeta Dutt and Shamshad Begum and all these songs. And I don't know, but in a typical family, when the parents know that the child sings and dances, so whenever there is some get together, they'll be like, beta, come here, please sing a song for uncle. And no, she sings really well, please sing a song. So I never as far as I remember, my parents say this, that I never used to shy away from singing. I never used to shy away from, showing what I have learned and singing it out loud. So I think that's when one of my dad's colleague, who's a Bengali, and his sister was actually a singer. So my dad's colleague said that, her voice is nice. This is what I thought. This is what I think. Why don't you enroll her into a music class? So, I started my training then under Dr. Mili Mehta, who was the sister of my dad's colleague. And she used to come to my place. I bought a harmonium and tabla and everything. and she used to come to my place, and we used to have a one-on-one class. And you know, it was initially very boring, if I say it bluntly, because in the initial beginning stage, we just identify the music. So if it's sa, we say sa 10 times, and you know, wo jo sthirta hai, jo stability hai music mein, to get that right. So initially it was you know, very boring, but you know, later on when I started singing bandishes, and so bandish is a short composition in the Hindustani music tradition, and when I started singing bandishes, I realized that it's much more than just swaras. So it's about what that composition is saying. How do you sing that composition with as much emotion as with which the composition has been written and has been composed? So how do you, you know, for example, how do you show the emotion of separation through music? How do you show an emotion of love through music? How do you show an emotion of fear through music? You know, so I learned variety of bandishes, which I really started enjoying. Plus, I'm very, one thing which I really like about dance and music is rhythm, which is one common factor. And I love playing with rhythms. So, you know, even if in my music class, we used to make taan, which is a very fast, you know, section of where you do that. So, so I used to, you know, make this in teen taal. If it's going, I used to say 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 1 1 1. So, you know, then I used to translate that like sarega 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 sare 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 sa 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 sa. You know, so that's how I used to play with the music and sort of make myself understand that, okay, this is how you know, we make the section. I started enjoying that, right? And similarly, later on in my journey, after my 12th, I took a gap year where I wanted to pause and reflect on where I want to be, what I want to do, what have I done earlier, what have been my experiences so far, and to learn from them and to sort of learnings from the past experiences so that, you know, I can move forward. And that 1 year made me realize in that one year I did theater, I did Bollywood singing, I did wedding choreographies, I did jazz dance, I did belly dancing, I traveled with my guru for some 15 spitmikes, and you know, I sort of learned compositions from my music teacher. I did so many variety of performing arts per se. And you know, after that gap year ended, that's when I realized that this is something which I want to do. And that 1 year passed by. I didn't even realize that how it went by. You know, that 1 year passed and I'm again standing, you know, in March next year. And I'm like, oh my God, 1 year is over. I finished my bachelor's and after that I took a gap year and it's over. And that's when I realized that this is something which I want to do. And I want to pursue in this. And so during that time, we didn't have any dance course in University of Delhi. So I looked for the music courses in University of Delhi because I wanted to be on either dance or music, but I wanted to be in these two streams. So that's when I enrolled myself in the Faculty of Music, which is University of Delhi. And I did my 2-year diploma course there. And further on, I moved on to do my master's in Hindustani music. So now that for those 4 years, the 2-year diploma and the 2-year master's, it opened another world for me. Now, earlier I was, you know, learning in my own house with my own teacher and, you know, not really focused on listening to other styles or gharanas of music. And there when I went, there are so many teachers. Each teacher has their own style. Each teacher has their own gharana. Each teacher has their own rag. And, you know, all that. And earlier, you know, when you are with parents who make you feel that, oh no, you sing really well. And you know, suddenly at a very young age, you see, yaha yaar, matlab, I sing really well, you know. But when I went to Faculty of Music, I was lost. I was like, there are so many good singing people. The people are, there's so many people who sing, like who are into this music area, like music scene. And that entire 4 years, I learned a lot from them as to, you know, how they started. Like some of them belong to music backgrounds. Some of them, you know, left their hometown and have come to University of Delhi to learn. So you know, that opened an entire world for me. So that was another experience. And then obviously I continued my training under Dr. Shoma Singh until now. I recently did performed at a global arts festival for music online. So which went well, and
that's actually very interesting. You talk about some two very important things. I think one of them has also repeated itself in the first question. The necessity and the need to look at nuances, right? To the nitty-gritties, the very simple details. And the other one is the idea of, you know, exposing yourself to different people, to as many things as possible, because you never know what lies outside of your little bubble. And it's important for you to step outside that bubble in order to actually understand what the world of arts or any form of art really looks like. Because we live in our small bubbles and we are like, okay, hum ja rahe hain class, hum wapas aa rahe hain, we are going to go, come back and, you know, do all of this back and forth. But by the time we step out of that bubble of ours, there is this huge, huge, huge industry that's set up, that's already working. And, you know, there's so much happening in the world already. So thank you for pointing that out. What is it about the nuances that you think makes the entire performance or like a practice whole? Because you talk a lot about nuances and their importance and the need for them. Maybe you could also give our audience an example on how you think a nuance essentially makes up for a beautiful performance.
Sure, Nihalika. So when I talked about nuances, so when we start training in an art form like dance or music, we'll just begin with a basic or a foundation level, right? When I say nuances, I say the beautification or the embellishments in both these art forms. So what happens is when as a child, when I'm learning, obviously the beautification and embellishments, it is a little tricky to understand at the beginning. But it's at a very later stage that you realize that this is what is making the whole thing come alive. You know, so for example, in music, and I recently performed this Thumri, in music, there is a line called laaj na ve, laaj na ve. So when I was taught this, I was only taught laaj na aave, laaj na aave. But you know, when I sort of understood what the emotion behind this particular line is, it's actually saying, don't you have any shame? Laaj na aave, laaj na aave, laaj na aave, laaj na aave. You know, so using those embellishments to kind of portray the emotion which is in the poetry is something which comes at a very later stage, but which is very important, because you know, at the end of the day, whatever we are conveying through dance or whatever we are conveying through music, the one common thread in this is emotion or the feeling which is behind what you want to convey, what you are doing. Similarly, in dance, when we start as beginners, we only start with normal steps, right? Which are called adavus. So, we keep our back straight. So all the rules have to be checked. Back straight, knees turned out, shoulders relaxed, chin up, and all that. It's at a very later stage when we sort of use, for example, looks like tai ya tai, tai ya tai. You know, so it's at a very later stage when we find these elements in dance which sort of enhance the dance much more and makes it. I think these nuances makes the art form very receptive, right? Because at the end of the day, when we are performing this for the audience also wants to see something on the face. It can't be just blank and saying teiya tei teiya tei, right? And these nuances, when I talk about, they're also related to poetry, right? Poetry of, for example, in dance, we usually have this telling the sakhi to go and get my lord, right? So, just saying this, please go and get my lord, please go and get my lord. The same dialogue, saying it in the same way for 5 times becomes a little mundane, right? And then the audience doesn't know what else to expect. So the face and the nuance, the embellishments, which I talk about, are very important when it comes to engaging the audience. So, sometimes, will you not do this for me? How many times should I say? Come on, aren't you my friend? So these dialogues, when they come into your head, it automatically translates into the body. And just a subtle shift of the neck and the hand or the face, aren't you my friend? Why are you being so rigid? When I say nuances are important, it actually makes the dance more receptive, more engaging, and something to look forward to. Okay, this is what she said here. This is what she said, and makes it a little happening. So I feel that it's very important, and I think dance and music both have actually taught me to sort of identify these little nitty-gritty things in my day-to-day life as well, right? Because the kind of life and the kind of lifestyle which the dancers and musicians have, it's very different. So, you have to take care of the body, you have to take care of the voice. You don't dance for one day, you feel you have not done enough. So these questions start coming and hitting you at night when you don't dance or when you don't do any exercise. So, making sure that that we enjoy those little things also in life, and especially during this situation, where all of us are at home, we are enjoying, like I'm enjoying just making or cooking something for myself, which is a very like a small thing, because we're so used to eating and having someone over and cooking for us, but yeah, so to enjoy these little things, that's what makes a whole picture, a complete picture. I hope I've answered your question.
Answered your question. You also demonstrated it, which makes this entire interview very exciting now. But on a side note, I think I do agree that a certain amount of nuance definitely in the right, for the lack of a better phrase, spices things up, right? It makes things exciting, worth looking forward to, and also things that we want to sort of, work and engage with. So But I also believe that we as people take these nuanced abilities of humans in for granted. We assume that it's okay for us to not feel or not express or not, appear in a certain way. So we all are like, nahi itta nuance. Why do we focus on nuances? It doesn't matter. And, you know, talking about enjoying those moments, you know, even the simplest of moments in life, I think that's where humanness comes into picture. Our ability to enjoy even the most simplest of tasks is what makes us human in the first place. So why not actually push ourselves to do it? You want to add something to it?
Yeah, no, I wanted to say that, you know, I'm still at the learning stage, but initially, I did not see the importance of nuance until I saw someone doing it. You know, so watching is something which is very important to understand different elements, right? So I think when I go for my classes, I watch my teachers, and I see how they do like one simple hand, and they will have 10 variations of it. The dialogue is the same, but you know they will use each and every part of the body, even the eyebrows, you know, even the lips, you know, and how the entire thing changes. So I think the nuance thing also, identifying those in our day-to-day life also comes with time. And if someone is doing, and if you're watching that person, you know, you sort of start thinking about it. So I think being aware about it. So yeah, that's what I wanted to add.
Thank you so much for all of that. I think that was that sort of sums everything up that we've been talking about in terms of nuances. I'm going to move on to the next question. And this one's quite slightly different from the discussion on performance and nuances. But it's a little bit about you and your experiences and how you've been working towards everything that you've done. So the question is as follows. So you've been a dancer, a choreographer, and an educator for the longest period of time, right? I think you've just recently become an educator as well. So adding that as one of the hats that you wear, how are you managing all of it? And, you know, what has your experience been in terms of being a performer versus being an educator, or maybe being a choreographer versus being a performer? Because I think all of them require a different kind of mindset and a different kind of sort of ability to be able to engage with all of those things. So tell us a little bit about how you've been managing it and what is it that you do in order to get yourself into the right headspace.
Right. So I think I'll divide my entire life into three stages because that's how it has been. I started as a dancer. Then I experienced doing the choreography parts of it. And then I became the educator. So the dancing part almost, it's continuing. And I'm very happy in a space which I am right now when it comes to dancing. My dancing is basically when I started dancing, and when I told my parents that I want to sort of pursue dance, there was a little apprehension as to where will the money come from, you know, is it sustainable, not sustainable? And I think because I was so confident at that time that I really want to do this and not anything else, I tried everything. Because in that one gap year, I tried everything. I tried theater, I tried all the other forms of dancing and everything. So, in that particular, when I had this conversation with my parents, so my parents sort of supported me and they said, but you will not, come back and say that this is, come back after 2-3 years and say that this is something which I don't want to do. If you are so confident right now and you are fighting with us to pursue this, then you should be sure of it. I said, yeah. So the dancing part is mostly has two parts to it. So one, there were solo choreographies, And the other section was the group choreographies, where I worked with different dancers. So in the solo choreography, obviously, more rehearsals go into, you know, planning that. And the ideation part, the execution part, it's all up to you. It's a lot of pressure. So the solo thing is an ongoing process. So it's not that abhi ek hafta maine nahi kiya. I didn't dance for like 1 week and then I again started the next week and then there is a gap. So it's an ongoing process. Even if I'm not dancing, at least I am thinking about it, or I'm documenting the pieces which I have done. But that's an ongoing process. When it comes to group choreographies in dancing, and I had the privilege of being part of the Natya Riksha Dance Company and the senior-most dancer there, one of the senior dancers of the company. And you know, in that space, I got to know how my teacher choreographs for the company, you know. And when it comes to choreography, there are multiple aspects. So one is working with a group. Everyone has a different body, right? Everyone has a different sense of music and rhythm, right? And not everyone is adept in music. So obviously in a group dance, it's dancing is something which is very important, right? So working with different bodies, working with different minds, working with you know, different heights also when it comes to bodies. How do you make it aesthetically so strong that it just like you look at it and you say, wow. You know, so I learned a lot about choreography in my guru's when I was part of the dance company. And, you know, there I also learned that there is a sense of awareness of space. So this is my space when we are dancing the stage. So in solo, you know, you have all the stage. You can move anywhere you want. You can choreograph any movement according to your thing. Right. But in group, it does not work like that. You have to be aware of your space and the space of the other people, and you know, how they are traveling through that stage, if they are. So even if we are doing a normal chatushram and we are going takadimi, 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 and you're looking there, so you have to be aware who's coming from here. So the sixth sense sort of plays. And now that, you know, six of us who are part of the dance company, we have done so many shows together, that now that we know that, okay, if I'm looking here and going there, I know I will not hit anyone, because now I can sense that she's not, you know, sort of going there. So that's what's happened in the group choreographies, understanding the music together, deciphering the rhythm structure together, and choreographing a movement together, looking how one movement looks, because in group we also need to make sure that all the movements look good in everyone's body, right? It's not one size fits all. So you know, how do you customize, maybe in a pairs of two, depending upon the height, or you know, things like that. So that's what I that's the group part. Now, this aspect I started exploring in my college days, which is, I was a part of Jesus and Mary College. So I did my bachelor's in commerce there, and I was part of the Indian Dance Society and the Indian Music Society. And so I was the vice president and the president of both the societies in, you know, back-to-back years. And I think the main part of the president is to actually prepare the team for the fests which are going to come, you know. So I, because being the president, I had to, you know, sort of prepare that. And so with the group, I started, so I did not experiment with Bharatanatyam. I experimented with folk. Usually all the festivals were about like folk dance competitions, right? So I picked up a folk dance form, which is Lavani, right? And so Lavani is a folk form from Maharashtra, and I'm not a Marathi. So, you know, so I researched about Lavani, researched about the costumes, researched about the music, researched about what the music is actually saying. So I had one of my friend who was a Marathi, and she sort of she sort of helped me in, telling me what the lyrics actually mean. And so, you know, as a challenge in during the choreography part, one biggest challenge was that not all dancers are available at all times, you know, because in college, people have classes, they have some students' classes used to get over at 12, and they used to have a practice at 3 p.m. And, you know, so what will they do for 3 hours? And those who had tuitions at 4, they could not join. So I used to really struggle with the choreographing when, you know, you don't have bodies to work on. So that's a biggest challenge for a choreographer, to sort of visualize that, okay, one person is there and one person is there. Okay, you three are here. Okay, start moving. Okay, this is how we'll look, and I will visualize, okay, if this person goes there, this person goes there, how will the choreography, how will the formation look? So that was one challenge. The second was, because we are not trained, or the group was not trained in any particular style, right? It's all the more difficult to bring them into a coordinated set of movements, right? Because the understanding of the body is not there, because they're not trained dancers. They're just people who love dancing and they do dancing, right? And that's what my criteria for auditions also was, that even if you're not a dancer, but you love dancing and you're ready to commit, you should come, right? So that was my idea. So the biggest challenge which I faced as a choreographer was not having enough bodies at the same time, and trying to instill them a sense of coordinated set of movements, a coordinated approach, and, you know, think about the music. And think, because now, you know, when I was working there, I realized that in my guru's group choreographies, everyone knew the music. Everyone was trained in one style, as opposed to here, where I have 10 students who are not trained in any dance style, who are maybe some are trained in music, some are not, you know, and they are the people who are not also doing, like, you know, regular fitness as such nahi hai in the daily routine. And this 3 to 4:30 is the one where I have to squeeze everything, and I have to do fitness also, I have to do choreography also, I have to do execution also. So that was one challenge, which was very interesting, because I learned about Lavani, I learned about a form, and and we won some 14 prizes that year, so which is great. The third stage is as an educator. I never did school teaching earlier. I was always a freelance teacher, or I was doing short-term courses, short-term assignments. So at the at Shivnada School, I was appointed as the Bharatanatyam facilitator, teaching faculty, where I used to learn, where I used to teach dance and obviously Bharatanatyam for the students who take that particular form. I will not say challenge, but one thing which sort of opened up was that how serious the school takes arts, you know. So when I sort of saw the in my school, in earlier days, arts was not given as much importance as it's being given right now. Whereas CBSE has also come up that it needs to be art integrated learning and all that, you know. So earlier it was not that. So the kind of expanse, the kind of faculty I saw at where I'm working, Shivnada School, was totally different from me. It was a different space. And everyone talking in, you know, educational terms. So I didn't know what, so, you know, terms like, okay, we need to follow this Bloom's taxonomy. We need to do this by PCRI. We need to do this by DOK. And at that time when I came, I'm like, okay, I don't know, but I can teach dance, but I don't know how to, you know, sort of go about it. And that's when my training started. And I learned from my peers a lot that it's just not teaching one form of dance to everyone, right? Differentiated learning was something which the school really focused on. And they really thought about each child, what are the strengths, what are the weaknesses, and how, even if the child is very hesitant to dance and not comfortable with the body, how do you make the child comfortable with the body, right? And at that time, you know, I think when I was going back, when I joined the school, I'm like, okay, I just need to teach Bharatnatyam. I'll teach Adavus. I'll teach Abhinaya pieces. You know, I had that set frame of mind. But, you know, the actual, then I realized that that's not something which the students would want to learn. It's not about the teachers, what I want to teach, what students would want to learn. Are there any skills which I want my students to learn at the end of this class? Yes. What are those skills? Are they a javali or a padam? No, that's not what they want to learn, right? So then, you know, finding different ways of engaging the children with dance. My first step was to actually just create a rapport with the students and make them feel comfortable about their bodies, and so that they can dance anywhere they want, right? Without thinking ki koi dekh raha hai, nahi dekh raha hai, if anyone is seeing me, you know? So like dancing our heart out. And then identifying each child as to what is the strength, what does this child need? One size fits all concept doesn't work in school. You can't just have one thing and give them like a bouquet and say, please take it, right? So when you do a class, it's like a bouquet of flowers, which each flower has its own quality, right? So I think that's what being an educator taught me, that, you know, sometimes it's as simple as engaging with the children and making them feel comfortable in your space, in the classroom space. It's as simple as that. Forget if they're not even learning a particular dance form or you know, just make them feel comfortable about their body, and skills will come later, at a later stage, when they start having fun, when they start knowing you, and you know, so yeah. But I'm still exploring the education space, and there's still a lot more to learn, because each day is a new learning experience, especially in this online learning mode. So I'm still learning, and I'm really looking forward to everything which is in store for me.
Very interesting. Thank you so much for that, Radhika. So there were two very interesting things that that caught my attention. But before I ask you a question about one of them, I think I would like to address the other one. And I want to add a little bit about what I feel about it as well. So you talk about empowering the students in your school, you know, in making them comfortable about their bodies, about how they feel and how they look and perceive themselves. I think that's something that has been in the talks recently, and everybody's talking about it. And something that's very important, the idea of creating a safe space for dancers where they don't feel judged or threatened, for that matter. And I think we just take it for granted so much, because we assume that every child comes from a similar household, and that their background and everything that they experience outside of maybe a dance class space, whether it's at your guru's place, or maybe it's where you teach your students at Kaladhwani, or even in the school, we assume that everybody's coming from a similar background, which is not true. And hence it becomes so important for us as teachers, educators, as performers who are, you know, sort of putting ourselves out there, trying to get students to understand the art form better. It becomes very important for us to first identify the fact that the students may want to just feel okay with who they are, how they look, how their bodies move, because not everybody's Aramandi is going to look the same. But training can get them to a place where they might actually be able to perform better with their own set of bodies. You know, and I think the identification and the, and just being able to say that, you know, ki this is okay at this moment where you are, this is okay. If you are not happy with it, we can work on it. There are training methods, there is technique that will help you get a better turnout for Aramandi, but it doesn't mean that, you know, the student's body itself is wrong. I think that's something very important and very, very, very necessary for us to all as educators, but especially to put it out there for every student to feel comfortable in their own spaces. So thank you so much for doing that in your classroom spaces. And, you know, being able to build that community in your own way, in whatever way is possible. Thank you all for tuning into Movement and Me, an initiative that is designed for budding artists across the world. To continue receiving notifications on our latest episode, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, Natya Mandalam, or look us up on Apple Podcasts or Spotify for more information. I'm your host, Niharika, and I'll see you all next time.